Now, let's continue with our analysis. We've already introduced how to deal with the maxpy on the right-hand side. In fact, we can express this maxpy as a function denoted as fv. Why so? Because the method for solving maxpy is to first fix v, which allows us to determine a pi. As for what this pi looks like, we don't need to worry about that, and we know that it is a function of v. Thus, the Bellman optimality equation becomes v equals fv. How simple is this equation? Moreover, this fv is actually a vector where, for a given state s, its element-wise form is as this. To solve the Bellman optimality equation, we just need to solve this equation. To do that, we need to introduce a contraction mapping theorem. This theorem is very important. Let's first see a concept called fixed point. If there's a point x in a set capital X, and a mapping or function f, where x satisfies fx equals x, then x is called a fixed point. Its intuitive interpretation is quite straightforward. Here's a point x, and fx is a function that maps back to itself, so this point does not move. Hence, it's called a fixed point. Another concept is contraction mapping or contractive function. A function is called a contraction mapping if it satisfies this inequality, which means that for any two points, the distance between their function values is less than the distance between the two points themselves, multiplied by a factor gamma, which is less than 1. What is the intuitive interpretation? Let's consider a very simple one-dimensional case. Suppose this is x1 and this is x2, then fx1 might be here and fx2 here. So x1 is mapped here and x2 there. This inequality implies that the distance between fx1 and fx2 is smaller than their original distance, which is why it's called contractive. Let's look at two simple examples to better understand the concept of fixed point and contraction mapping. Consider the equation x equals fx, where fx is 0.5x, with x being a scalar. It's easy to verify that 0 equals 0.5 times 0. Therefore, 0 is a fixed point. Is fx equal to 0.5x a contraction mapping? The answer is yes. For any x1 and x2, the norm of 0.5x1 minus 0.5x2 can be expressed as 0.5 times the norm of x1 minus x2. Here, 0.5 is less than a factor gamma, like 0.6 or 0.7, both of which are less than 1, fulfilling the definition of a contraction mapping. Therefore, 0.5x is a contraction mapping. Similarly, we can generalize this to when x is a vector and A is a matrix. When the matrix norm of A is less than 1, 0 is still a fixed point, and AX is also a contractive mapping according to the inequality. With these concepts, we can introduce the contraction mapping theorem, a powerful theorem that is useful not only in this course but also in many other fields. If F is a contraction mapping, then for the equation X equals FX, the contraction mapping theorem suggests three important results. First, existence. Regardless of the specific expression of F, if it is a contraction mapping, there exists a fixed point, X star satisfying FX star equals X star. Second, uniqueness. This fixed point is unique. Third, the theorem offers an iterative algorithm for finding the fixed point, XK plus 1 equals FXK. If I start from x0, I can compute x1 using this algorithm. By substituting x1 back, I can compute x2 and so on. Xk will ultimately converge to its fixed point, x star, as k goes to infinity. Of course, in practice, we don't need to let k reach infinity. After running a finite number of steps, we can obtain a result that is satisfactorily accurate. Moreover, the convergence rate towards x star is exponentially fast. For the proof of the contraction mapping theorem, we won't discuss it here. There's a very detailed proof in my book. If you're interested, you can see the book. Next, I briefly demonstrate this theorem through two examples. First, consider the equation x equals 0.5x, which we previously analyzed. We know x equals 0 is a fixed point, and now we understand that it is a unique fixed point. Moreover, we now know that such a fixed point can be found through this algorithm. This example is simple, so we can directly see that the fixed point is 0. The algorithm also demonstrates convergence to 0. For instance, if we start with x0 being 10, then x1 would be 5 and x2 would be 2.5, clearly showing a trend towards 0. Similarly, if X is a vector and A is a matrix, we can achieve similar results. With the contraction mapping theorem, we can apply it to solve the Bellman optimality equation. This is the expression of the Bellman optimality equation, V equals FV, which is similar to the problem addressed by the contraction mapping theorem. To apply the contraction mapping theorem, we first need to prove that FV, which is part of the Bellman optimality equation, is a contraction mapping. We can actually prove this inequality where gamma is the discount rate that is less than 1. Thus, FV is a contraction mapping. As to why this function has this property and why this conclusion holds, we won't talk about the details here. If you are interested, the details are available in my book. After proving that F is a contraction mapping, we can directly apply the contraction mapping theorem to solve the Bellman optimality equation. Several conclusions can be drawn. There always exists a solution, denoted as V star, which is unique. Furthermore, this solution can be iteratively found, with Vk eventually converging to V star. Let's further analyze the optimality of the solution to the Bellman optimality equation. Suppose V star is the solution to this Bellman optimality equation, which can be obtained using the algorithm we mentioned just now. Then, pi star represents the optimal solution for V star, meaning we fix V star first and then solve a policy pi, which we denote as pi star. Consequently, this equation transforms into this one by removing the max pi and replacing it with pi star, turning it into a Bellman equation. As we know, every Bellman equation corresponds to a specific policy, in this case, pi star. Therefore, V star here is essentially V pi star, which is the state value corresponding to pi star. This reveals that the Bellman optimality equation is a special Bellman equation. Whether this policy is indeed optimal and whether V star or V pi star represents the greatest state value are still questions to be answered. In fact, the solution V star to the Bellman optimality equation is the highest state value compared to any other policy. Hence, pi star is also an optimal policy because the state value corresponding to pi star, V pi star, is optimal. I won't talk about the proof of this theorem here, but you can find the details in my book. While we know that pi star is indeed an optimal policy, let's discuss next what pi star looks like. In fact, it looks like this at state S. Pi star selects A star, which corresponds to the action with the highest action value. For this action, the policy assigns a probability of 1, and for all other actions, a probability of 0. This policy is both deterministic and greedy, focusing solely on selecting the action with the highest action value.